Welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Today we shall be discussing which party has the youth vote. Has Prime Minister Narendra Modi been able to retain the youth vote, or is a resurgent Rahul making inroads? And what about the X factor, the Kejriwal, the Nitish Kumar, or even the Naveen Patnaik? For that, let me introduce my panel. We have from the Congress National Spokesperson RPN Singh, former Union Minister. We have National Spokesperson of the BJP, Samvit Patra. We have Seema Goswami, columnist. And we have Kalike Singhdeo, an MP from the BJD. Samvit, I'm going to begin with you. Now, a lot of people are saying with this talk of, you know, the Hindutva and this, you know, learn Sanskrit instead of German, all this thing. Is Narendra Modi retaining the vote that really swung him to power, the youth vote?
In fact, yesterday I participated in one of the debates in one of the prime channels, Hindi channels, and they had a survey to this effect by the Nielsen. So ABP Nielsen, I think, is a fairly reputed survey thing. And they presented saying that Mr. Modi still retains the charm that he has within the youth.
But what has he done to retain the charm? You know, we just have that Rohit Vemula suicide also.
You have to understand as to what the youth needs in this country. First and foremost, youth needs a leader who can lead from the front. Secondly, youth needs a leader who can provide them what the requirement is. That is employment, I believe, is a prime requirement. Let's see what Mr. Modi has done for the youth. First, the transparency that he had guaranteed, he stands by the transparency because youth wants it all transparent, non-corrupt way. Secondly, Startup India, Stand Up India, Mudra Bank, Make in India. These have all guaranteed the kind of employment that we had promised while we came into power. And I was going to the Business Standard's recent article, which suggested that, well, even the statistics suggest what we had promised, that the employment is going up as to what it was in the previous regime. So naturally, if the youth is given employment, they would love their prime minister. Secondly, and very importantly, a very important step was taken on 1st of January 2016, which we might have forgotten, but it's essentially one of the most important steps as far as the youth, particularly pertaining to the lower middle class and the rural background is concerned. That is to do away with the interviews for the grade 3 and the grade 4 employment. This is a very important step. Do you know, I mean, people had to spend a lot of money as bribes. Om Prakash Chautala is in jail for this thing. Just imagine a chief minister in jail just because he was into a recruitment scam. Okay. Then you have...
Let me first bring RPN before you go on with all the... Do you buy him? He thinks there's nothing to worry about. Modi is doing great.
Oh, well, one thing I can definitely say, Priya, is that during the last Lok Sabha elections, there was a huge surge of younger people voting for the BJP, and they voted in numbers, which is very evident from all the statistics we have. But why did they vote for Mr. Modi? That is the key thing. They voted for a great economy. They voted for black money coming back. They voted for the rupee not falling, not hitting the Margdarshak age of the BJP. He spoke about 2 crore jobs a year. Am I right, Samit? 2 crore jobs a year?
Come to that.
No, was it 2 crore jobs a year? Well, it's not even 30 lakhs. So, as Samit said, that they're catching up. Well, 2 years are nearly coming to an end. They still haven't caught up with the UPA, the kind of jobs the younger generation was getting. As he spoke about the what's happening in rural India, be it farmers or their farmers' children, be it what's happening in every campus in India, unfortunately, be it in what we saw what happened, unfortunately, in Hyderabad, we see it happening in Tamil Nadu, we see it happening in Uttar Pradesh, we see it happening in Delhi, we see it happening in every university campus where the BJP's organizations are trying to push their own agenda. And the youth are up in arms. Well, I'm a small man, I can only tell Narendra Modi ji that be careful of the youth because they can get anybody off any chair anytime.
As the Congress knows all too well. Kalikesh, do you agree with him blaming the Modi for all that is wrong?
Look, if anybody claims to have the youth vote, I think it's a complete fallacy. The youth is an aspirational vote. They go with the best option at the best time and a person or in a party which indicates maximum amount of hope for them. Yes, last time around it was for Narendra Modi. The time before that it was for the Congress. Correct. And nobody can claim to have a fixated hold on the youth. My perspective, my feeling from the grassroots is that both the Congress and the BJP are losing the youth vote very fast. There's been, of course, a lot of despair on the last 10 years of Congress rule. Even Narendra Modi, I think, has not achieved the kind of success that he hoped to achieve, or he ensured the youth that he would achieve. I think that the economy has been a non-starter in large sense. Some jobs improvement figures have come in, but by and large, the kind of hope, it may have been exaggerated hope, but the kind of hope the youth had on Narendra Modi or the BJP has not come through. In my view, that the youth continues to shift. We've seen it in Nitish Kumar's election. The entire youth vote went largely to him. We saw it in Delhi with Arvind Kejriwal. It's going to be a fragmented vote in the next coming election.
Seema, you know, we've all talked about how Modi is not really keeping in touch. What about Rahul Gandhi? What has Rahul done, you know, just going to campuses to meet people after an event is not really connecting with the youth?
Priya, before I answer your question, I really don't think there's any such thing as a youth vote.
Okay.
There are some young people who are predisposed towards the BJP. There are some young people who are predisposed towards the Congress. I don't think the youth vote is a monolith and you can appeal to it by doing A, B, C, D. Because there will be a liberal constituency, there will be a right-wing constituency. So I think let's not get into it that all the youth are going to vote in a certain way. As far as what Rahul Gandhi is doing, I think on the face of it, he's doing a good thing because he's actually going and connecting with people. He is going and talking to them. He's taking questions, which he's trying to answer as best he can. People may think he's not answering them right or wrong, but the very fact that he's taking questions is a big deal. I can't remember the last time Narendra Modi addressed a young audience and took questions from them. In fact, the last time he went to a university to address people, there were, I think, people in the audience shouting, "Modi, go back," because of the Rohit Vemula suicide. And instead of actually addressing those concerns, those young students were evicted from the hall. If Narendra Modi wanted to appeal to the youth vote, he should have called those students back, talked to them, understood their concerns, instead of having them evicted, because that is how you appeal to the youth, by being transparent, by being open, by communicating, which he did until he became Prime Minister. So I think there is a definite shift in the way he's communicating.
Somebody, does Modi need to do a course correction? You know, Seema pointed out a very good example. He could have easily gone out, reached out to the people. What Rahul is doing now, belatedly?
Let me pick a few examples of what Rahul has been doing.
First, you
tell Modi. I'll come to everyone. Okay. In fact, I'll give you a comparative statistics over here. If you'd remember as to how Rahul went to a Bangalore university and how he was booed, in fact, there he wanted to bring in politics by saying that, okay, well, the policies, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan and all these are not successful, and he was booed there. Then you remember when the startup
India
actually,
that's not true. He was not booed there.
He was booed.
So I'll answer that. I didn't want to interject because he's speaking. He was not booed. I'll just come to that. Let him, please.
Okay.
He was booed there. I would still continue saying that. And and secondly, you would remember when Rahul recently, on 15th of January, he was in a university addressing the students there on Startup India. A day before the Startup India was to begin on January 16th, he made it too political. And I was looking into the reactions of the students. They were right in pointing out, we did not learn anything. It was too much of politics. It would have been really good if Rahul would have mellowed down the politics and would have really interacted with us. So I believe, look, I mean, what does the youth want out of your leader? The youth wants a reflection of oneself in their own leader. The irony is, though Rahul is young by age, but the youth does not see the reflection of oneself in Rahul. Otherwise, Rahul would have done fairly well in the 2014 Lok Sabha election because he was at the prime of his youth then. Modi may not be as young as Rahul. He may be in his 60s. But then the youth believes that he is the aspirational India. He is the man who can take on the problems head on.
Do they still believe that? They believed it when they voted for him, even now, today.
Priya, I would say people still believe it. I firmly believe this from my bottom of the heart. But since I observe him on day-to-day basis, a number of functions, I am there when he's there as a guest. And I see the kind of vibration that the youth populace in that particular event has when Mr. Modi arrives or when he gives up a hand for a handshake. I have watched at least two prime ministers prior to Mr. Modi. I had seen as to what was the reaction when it was Manmohan Singh. I've even seen presently what is the reaction when Rahul Gandhi comes to young crowd.
That he didn't answer the question why Modi is not reaching out to the youth of this country. Well, obviously, the only defense they have, they go to Rahul Gandhi. Rahul Gandhi is going to the universities and talking to the thing, and he was not booed. But he has the courage to stand up and take questions which are uncomfortable. Mr. Narendra Modi can't even take comfortable questions because he's never been, he doesn't take questions. He has people evicted, as Seema said. So it would be better if he answered the questions of the youth. Rahul Gandhi has the strength of courage, strength of conviction, that he goes to these universities and listens to what they have to say. As he's talked about Startup India, we've had some great startups this year. Be it Digital India, That India, This India, That India. But no follow-up, unfortunately, some with great shows. As Mr. L.K. Advaniji put it, the greatest event manager, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. He's the greatest event manager, but unfortunately, he's got 20 months down the line. Stop berating and talk propping about Rahul Gandhi. It's 20 months. You made huge promises to the youth of this country. How about telling them what you've done for them? And you said you'll answer that question. Was it 2 crore the job
somewhere? I'll come to the job as
well. No, but just one point I want to make from what Sambit said. He said Rahul Gandhi goes to campuses and does politics. What is wrong with that? He's a politician. He's there to take the message of his party. That is political.
I'll give you the example.
Why should he not do politics? Narendra Modi does politics when he goes to America, when he goes to any foreign country and he addresses crowds of NRIs. He does politics.
I'll give you
why can't Rahul do politics in university?
No, I'll tell you as to why I feel what Rahul could have done better. For instance, when he went to Bangalore, when he was addressing the students saying that please vote, whether Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is a success or failure, I feel it was a failure. So don't you feel it's a failure? The students said no.
Half of them said yes.
Let him finish. What Rahul should have done as a positive politician, what he should have done is, well, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is an apolitical thing. Why don't we all contribute towards it? If it is not being a success, let's go out. You are young students. I'm a young guy. Let's take a broom in the hand, go out to the streets and leave a message for the people of the state.
But he
doesn't do that.
When was the last time Narendra Modi did that?
Look, I'll tell you.
Narendra Modi did.
Just a second. Narendra Modi did drive home a message.
That's the justice.
Let's have a finish.
No.
I think if we are debating, it's not a laugh all around.
No, I don't. I agree. It's not.
Let's be disciplined, civil and practical.
Yeah, positive.
Yes. Look, Mr. Narendra Modi did carry a broom. Mr. Narendra Modi did send a message, and the message drove home because of the very fact that every second day we are discussing, debating, good or bad, about Swachh Bharat Abhiyan.
Quickly, RP, and then I want to get
the one thing is with Samvit is when he wants a discussion, the discussion is only Samvit talks and we just listen to him. So discussion
fair,
is not
been
that.
Letting two of
so
talk
I'll just something. I will just take 1 minute. Swachh Bharat is something that was under the name. This is something started by the Congress Party, the Nirmal Yojana. And let's talk about Swachh Bharat. It's a very good scheme. Everybody believes, even the Congress believes, and anyone in India would believe it about being Swachh Bharat. Why shouldn't it be a clean India? But when the budget of Swachh Bharat was cut, why was the budget of Swachh Bharat cut? If you want a cleaner India, don't you back it up with funds? Why wasn't the budget of Swachh Bharat cut?
Actually, they put a lot of money through CSR into creation of toilets. But they, both of you made the same mistakes. You're building toilets without putting electricity or water. Try using a toilet at the end of the day without it being cleaned in a school. It won't work. It doesn't happen. Besides that, you know, I think listening to Samvid and RPN, listening to RPN and Samvid, and I'm quite certain that the youth will neither have hope on Narendra Modi nor on Rahul Gandhi. And if you limit it to these two individuals, you're really limiting your discussion. The fact is that last time round in 2014, there was immense aspirational vote for Narendra Modi. It's not going to happen next time. Let's be very clear on that. While Narendra Modi may enjoy in my opinion, a slightly higher acceptability in rural India amongst the youth than Rahul Gandhi does for the time being, you still have 3 years to go, is not going to be one-sided at all. It's not going to happen in the same manner. What's going to happen, in my opinion, is going to be very, very fragmented, where individual MPs or MP candidates will have a large hold on the electoral practices, where regional leaders like Naveen Patnaik or Nitish Kumar or Arvind Kejriwal or a Kejriwal will continue to have a huge sway on elections. It's not going to be a one-stop shop like the last time around. And the simple reason that it's not going to happen that way is because not enough has been done, Samvid. You can say Rahul is bad. You can say that last 10 years Congress did a lot of stuff. And
no argument, sir.
You're not being able to do what you promised. And that's a fact. You're going to lose a lot of state in the coming years.
Okay, Seema, I know you want to come in, but Modi is losing his grip perhaps on the youth vote, but Rahul is also not retaining that grip. You know, he's trying stuff, but
no,
it's
Rahul never had a grip. He never had a grip. Let's not mince any words about it. I don't think he ever had a grip on the youth vote. But I think the problem with Narendra Modi's functioning so far, he had very good ideas. But the youth of today, they are not like us who grew up with a dial-up connection. They are the ones who have Wi-Fi. They want everything now. And they want it right there. They don't want to struggle, they don't want to wait. When your reaction time is so late, whether it's the FTII campus problems, or whether it's Rohit Vemula, when your reaction time becomes 5 days, a degree of pessimism sets in among the youth that the Prime Minister is not addressing our concerns. He's doing A, B, C, D, but he's not addressing our concerns. I'm not saying that he doesn't want to address their concerns. I'm talking about the optics that Narendra Modi used to be very quick off the bat. The moment anything happened, he would react. He's not doing that anymore.
And also, is it, you know, Team Modi? You know, it's not just Modi himself, it's also his ministers. You know, when they make these statements, what we call the hardline Hindutva ones, and they are not stopped, they continue to control the narrative, that doesn't send a good message. Because what we want is, we want to see more of startups, more of digital India, more of stuff that, you know, making things happen, making those jobs happen.
The problem is, we consider the youth immature. It's not that the youth wants everything now, exactly now. No, the youth understands. Look, let's compare between Modi and Rahul, if at all that's what we are doing, amongst others also. Youth wants, youth means energy, it means a great deal of vibration, and that's what Mr. Modi representing. He is representing a whole deal of energy. I mean, the country is watching as a, and a prime minister who is watching, who is working 24/7, 365 days. We have seen up till now the prime minister not taking a single leave. Secondly, we are watching
even
Rahul
Manmohan Singh didn't take a single leave.
No, Manmohan Singh was a different person altogether. His body language, the way he, it is all perception. Okay. He may be, I firmly believe Manmohan Singh would be remembered more as a finance minister than as a prime minister. As far as Rahul is concerned, we see the epileptic way of working, you know. He goes into epileptic mode of working, and then suddenly he has to go to a foreign destination for undisclosed or an undisclosed destination for a period of time.
As far as Rahul Gandhi was there, Rahul Gandhi never led a government. Rahul Gandhi came into politics when already 5 or 6 years. That was his age. The thing is, he could not offer aspirations. He could not give them or sell a dream because we were in power. Modi sold a dream, and a dream which has been deflated as fast in 1 year. The dream which Modi sold has been deflated. If you see what is happening in this country and you see the kind of level of opposition to the BJP and Mr. Narendra Modi, and you see the elections from Delhi onwards, what is happening, see it by-elections, be it state elections, there is a feeling of despondency, there's a feeling of being let down. Yes, there are people, I would say, still in cities who Samvit is saying, are still talking about, yes, let's give him a chance. Hmm. But Rahul Gandhi's connect with the youth now, when he's in opposition, reaching out to the problems, and he's not selling dreams. He's telling them the harsh reality. So that bubble is not going to burst within a year.
Okay, we're going to come back. Yeah, we just need to take a quick break. But we're going to come back and see who really has his pulse on aspirational India. But after a quick break. Welcome back to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. We are discussing the youth vote. Kalikesh, you know, you're right, you know, neither Rahul nor Modi. You know, Modi may be losing his grip, Rahul never had a grip. What about Kejriwal? You know, let's talk about him for a change. Or say Nitish Kumar, or even a Naveen Patnaik. Any of these people could, you know, emerge?
Oh, Kalikesh.
Yes.
Let's not.
That was my job.
Well, you're giving us the right youthful look today.
Look, listen. I think, you're right, neither Modi nor Rahul have actually hit the button as far as youth is concerned. And ultimately the youth will go at the and decide at the last minute. They don't want to be a pre-planned. They're not a caste vote which will be with one political party. They're not a religious vote which will go with a certain issue. They go on the person who gives them the maximum amount of aspiration and hope. What I do feel is happening is that they're still waiting on Narendra Modi. They still have a reasonable amount of goodwill on him. They don't like the BJP. They don't like the NDA government in power. The NDA government, apart from Modi, has very few charismatic, competent leaders who have demonstrated governance abilities. Very few.
Yeah.
And very few actually appeal to the youth. So they have not sold on the NDA government at all, but they still have some hope in Modi. He's still selling dreams to them. Let's see how that pans up.
Exactly what Mr. Singh was saying, that Rahul Gandhi did not choose the responsibility of being a leader, into the government then, because his age did not permit. Why, if a 39-year-old Smriti Irani can be a minister, why not a 42-year-old?
Thank God he's not a Smriti Irani.
Just a second. No, please don't demean a minister.
No, I'm not
lady.
Being, but I don't no, want don't, him to
don't,
be a Smriti Irani.
Don't demean a minister.
I'm not demeaning
him. He's just saying that he does not have to be that.
He doesn't want to be a Smriti Irani even at 39.
No, how? Exactly. My question is, did he try? He could have been better. Who knew? But he did not try because he did not want his hands to be full of responsibility.
No, it's not a responsibility.
Just a second, sir.
Just a second.
The one who runs away from responsibility right from the day one, why are we discussing about the future of that person at all?
No, because he is
not
the leader of the party. But
he did not run away from responsibility.
I'll tell you one thing.
When he came into politics, The Prime Minister of this country was Dr. Manmohan Singh. The Congress President was Mrs. Sonia Gandhi. He started working for the party. He could not decide what was going to happen in the government. He came in when already the policies were there. The policies which he thought were right, he supported them. And the policies or the acts which he thought were not right, he raised his voice against them.
Nirbhaya thing, you know, I remember you as Home Minister, you went out to the crowds, you met them, you managed them, and that actually brought in some goodwill to the people. Rahul could have done the same.
No, Mrs. Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi met the protesters. It is something they didn't do
days.
It in front
Much
of...
later.
And, no,
days.
Not 21 days. I was there. I was present as Mrs. Gandhi. Protesters went to Mrs. Gandhi's house at 12 o'clock at night. She called the protesters for a meeting at 9 o'clock. There was Mrs. Gandhi, there was
Rahul Gandhi. Behind the cameras.
But why must... This is what I mean.
No, but one
politics.
Second. When
one
did,
minute, Seema.
When has Narendra Modi met the protesters
were
Rohit Vemula?
He also has
he to company
but
on
But unfortunately, what you said it, but let's get into that discussion. Everything has to be done in front of the camera, be it holding the Prime Minister of France
so
to get him into the right pose, get the CEO of Google, place him so the camera comes in place. So politics cannot be run by television. You know,
so all the belcha that Rahul Gandhi was holding,
they have to be
all
more
the
solid
home
than
visit.
Just photo ops.
That was
you know, what you said, Mr. Modi, I give that to him. He's extremely good at using camera. And he is using it, but you cannot be a prime minister and
why
say
why is such a big secret
ops.
If Sonia Gandhi met the protesters Nirbhaya?
No,
why
I
is
came
it such
and
a
briefed the
secret?
Press after that. I gave a prayer. I got it still on my phone. I told him, yes, I have a thing. I still have it.
But you were saying it was the middle of the night and no one knew?
But at 12 o'clock, no cameras were there at our house.
No, but Priya,
I
the press and media are very much part of today's politics. You can't ignore them, RPN.
What?
Press and media,
yes,
you have to, be, you have to manage
what
the press.
Problem
now,
with the
what
I think Rahul does it also and Modi does it very well. Let's be clear on
actually,
that.
Actually, I disagree with that. I don't think that this government has a media policy. There is no information flow. It comes in dips and drabs. It comes from
there
leaks.
There is no leakage.
There are lots of leaks. There are lots of leaks.
There is no government information.
No, what I mean is there is no information flow. There has to be a systematic flow of information from the government to the media. If you don't have that, in that absence, obviously there will be leaks and speculation. Where is the information flow? You don't have a media advisor to the government. So, I mean, Modi addressing a meeting cannot be media management. No, there has to be some information flow. I mean,
as far as media is concerned, as far as the information is concerned, the PIB speaks its own.
No,
I mean, whatever the policies
are,
the cabinet briefings are concerned, the cabinet briefings are
Modi announces
I mean, look at the after Pathan court.
Nobody else does so. Modi announces the policy, the larger policies of government. Nobody else does so. And that's the way they're managing it. What's wrong with that?
What's wrong with that is there's a huge gap.
You may not have enough fodder.
We do not have a block Chatterjee. We do not have a block Chatterjee who rushes all the files.
Is it your view? Priya?
The Prime Minister
has
I need to ask Kalikesh this. Is it your view that a government's job is just to give information?
No, so there are two roles of the government.
So they are not supposed to answer any questions. They're only supposed to give information and that's it.
It's about transparency. At the end of the day, however you brief the public,
it's upon the government to choose what they want to brief.
No, I don't agree at all.
Actually, yeah,
no, the
they can choose certain aspects of the governance policies that they choose to follow, which they have already announced.
And not take questions.
And not take questions.
Oh, that
and is they are not answerable to anyone.
No, absolutely, absolutely. I think every leader
not answerable
needs
every
to be answerable.
Day, no. Every second day you talk
sense.
Of intolerance.
But
they are answered.
The only person
answerable?
Who's answerable to the public is you, because you're on TV every day. Not the Prime Minister, no?
Somebody is doing, somebody is answering all the questions of the BJP.
Are we all doing our duties?
Okay, on that note, I'm sorry, I'll have to wrap it up. But that's all from us for now. Thank you for watching this edition of Roundtable. We'll see you again same time next week.